Hello, everyone, and welcome to the first installment of Science at STSCI. This new video series will give you a look inside the Space Telescope Science Institute and provide an opportunity for you to learn about some of the amazing, groundbreaking science that's being done here. I mean, there's some really cool stuff going on here, and astronomers here get to use some of the best instruments on the forefront of astronomy research. They are using data from the Hubble, Kepler, Spitzer, and Chandra space telescopes, ground-based telescopes from all over the world, and, well, I want to show you some of that awesome stuff. Seems a shame to just leave it all under one roof and not let the word out. So we'll also look ahead as well at some of the discoveries of the future that the upcoming Webb Space Telescope will surely provide us. That work will also be done here, so I actually plan to have a lot to show you. So let's get started. This week, we're going to look at some cool work being done using Kepler data. Kepler is a space telescope launched in 2009 that was designed to help us find planets around other stars, and has so far confirmed 76 planets with another over 1,500 planet candidates waiting for confirmation. Kepler finds planets by measuring tiny dips in brightness of a star as a planet passes between us and the parent star. But Kepler is not just helping us find planets around other stars. Because it is staring at one spot in the sky for a long time and measuring the brightnesses of over 100,000 stars at once, there's a lot of other useful, really cool science that could be done using this data. For example, since Kepler has been staring at the same spot in the sky since 2009, and will continue to do that until at least 2016, any science questions that involve watching something for a long time can be answered using Kepler data. And this week, I found someone doing just that. Earlier, I spoke with Michael Wolf, a research instrument analyst who's been using Kepler data to find flares around the stars inside the Kepler field of view. Remember, Kepler's detectors are extremely sensitive to changes in light from a star. I mean, they have to be in order to be able to find any planets that may be passing in front of it. I mean, for instance, an Earth-sized planet passing in front of a Sun-like star dims it by a factor of less than 1/100 of 1%, and a Jupiter-sized planet by about 1 to 2%. Those are pretty small changes in brightness. This means they are also sensitive enough to detect changes in the activity on the star's surface. In this case, stellar flares. Flares just like the sun has. I mean, I hadn't really thought about using Kepler data this way, but I guess it makes perfect sense that we should be able to make measurements like these. Anyway, here are some details. Hello, everybody. I'm sitting with Dr. Michael Wolf at the Space Telescope Science Institute, and he's an astronomer here. And he works on on the Kepler project, at least part of his time, using Kepler data. And Mike, when I was here in your office a couple of weeks ago, we were working on some other problem, and I happened to notice that your code had a title in it called Kepler Flare. Right. And of course, that piqued my interest. And I said, I got to talk to Mike more about this. So, apparently the Kepler spacecraft, which is looking at transiting planets and stars in the constellation Cygnus, yes. Is able to see flares?
Yes, it does. We're able to really get very good photometry from the Kepler spacecraft. And if we look right here, this is what we're getting from the spacecraft.
And these are light curves?
These are light curves. So that's what that is that's it plots how the star's flux changes with time.
Okay. And so explain some of these graphs to us. This top graph here, this is what exactly are we looking at?
So what we're looking at right here is actually this is the light curve, but we've normalized it to the mean of the light curve. So we have this and we subtracted one from it, so we get this number around zero. So that's what we're seeing right here. So this is just the flux itself.
And what's the second derivative below that?
So what the second derivative, I don't know if you're aware of what the second derivative does, but it measures the convex, where it goes from being positive to being negative slope. So what this is really measuring here, this is measuring the greatest change in the flare or in the light curve. If we take a look right here, as this goes up, right, this is a positive slope. But then we have this turnover where it starts, so we have this sharp increase, and then we have this exponential decay. So the peak here is where we most likely are going to get the largest value for the second derivative in absolute value.
And that inflection point, or that change in peak there, why is that significant?
That's an excellent question. I don't really know. Actually, that's a very significant question because this is a very active field of research for stars.
So these are analogous then to the solar flares we see here.
Yes.
Okay, so these are magnetic reconnection events or recombination events on the stars mm-hmm. around Kepler that Kepler are visiting.
And actually, these are all based off of the sun. Okay. So when we're looking, we're getting 10 to the 35 flare ergs right here, we're basing this off of 10 to the 33 ergs, which is the value of the sun, the luminosity of the sun.
Oh, I see.
So we're using the sun as baseline.
So do you see any peculiar patterns in the flares of some of these stars, or?
I haven't had enough time to look at that yet. The project really is in its infancy.
Well, that's great. Thank you, Mike, very much for sharing this with us. Now, one other thing I'd like to ask you real quick is what made you get into astronomy in the first place?
Well, I've always been interested in science ever since I was a kid. I've always been interested in astronomy, you know, space, science fiction, stuff like that. That's always piqued my interest. And so, actually, I came to astronomy because I was bored with a job that I had. I had been in the Navy for 6 years, and I got out and I was working at a tile manufacturer. So it was pretty mundane, because being in the Navy, you know, I was a second class petty officer, so I had a lot of responsibility and a lot of challenges. But when I went to Dow Tile, I got out of the Navy and went to Dow Tile, they just weren't there. And so I got really bored with it really quickly. And so how I got it going into college was I read this layman's book called The Dancing Wu Li Masters by Gary Zukav.
Yeah, I know the book, yeah.
And so at the time, most of it went right over my head. But, you know, anybody that tells you that they understand quantum mechanics is lying to you.
Amen, brother, amen.
If they say that, then they really have no idea what they're talking about. So I read that book, and quite frankly, I had no idea what it was. So I read a couple of other nonfiction books, you know, layman's books, and it just got my interest piqued going to college. So when I went to college I was 29. I was initially an anthropology major, and then I took an astronomy 101 course, and that really just revitalized my interest in astronomy. And so that's when I decided to become an astronomer. So anybody that watches this, you can do this at any age you want to. I went to college when I was 29, and I had to start out. I couldn't even add fractions together. So 20 credits of my math don't even count. So I had to go from adding fractions together to college-based algebra and all that math in between that, which was 20 credits. Didn't count. I had to learn it all. So I ended up I have a minor in mathematics.
Yeah, that's funny.
Washington.
It's funny how that works out with physics. You don't need to take that many more math classes to get that minor if you're in the physics course of study. So that's very interesting. I almost did the same myself. That's a great story. Well, Mike, thank you very much for taking the time to talk to us. I appreciate it.
No problem. Anytime.
All right. Thank you. Well, that's it for this week, Space Fans. Thank you guys for watching. And as always, keep looking up. Really cool, huh? As the year progresses, Mike should have some pretty good statistics on the characteristics and nature of stellar flares occurring on the surfaces of stars that Kepler continues to stare at. I'll keep you posted. Well, that's it for this week. Thank you all for watching, and as always, keep looking up.